Hallelujah, Jesus. He's worthy. Glory to God. Glory to God. Messiah Temple Missionary Baptist Church Choir. We invite you to help us welcome in today a very special guest. Now, if the President of the United States, the Honorable Barack Obama, was to walk through those doors, we would stand on our feet and we would give him the honor that he deserves. If the Queen of England was to come through those same doors, right here at 10400 South Dr. B. S. Sarfi Drive, we would bow down and we would give her the honor that she deserves. For some of you sports fans, or some of you who love these pop stars, if the Cubs was to come through those doors, or if Kanye West or Nicki Minaj, you would stand on your feet and you would be excited. Hallelujah. But on today, we have a very special guest. And no, he is not the President of the United States, but he does deserve all honor. And no, he's not the Queen of England, but he deserves all the glory. And he may not be a great athlete, but he finished the race for me. He stayed his course. The day that he was born, the Father hung Bethlehem star in the sky, and three wise men seen it from afar, and they rushed to see the little baby where he lay. And somebody ought to get excited about Jesus. I'm talking about Jesus, he who died for us, saved our souls, made us whole. Somebody ought to adore him. Come, let us adore him. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Worship him. Worship him. Hallelujah. For unto us a child was born, a son was given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and we shall call him Wonderful Counselor, Prince of Peace. Come on, somebody, Mighty God. Hallelujah. Come and let us adore him, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Have he been your way out of no way? Your bridge over troubled water. The healer, the balm of Gilead. Healed your body. Saved your soul. In the name of Jesus. He's worthy. Somebody ought to tell him thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. He came down through 42 generations just to restore us back to the Father, the propitiation of sin. Jesus Christ, hallelujah. The one who died for us, hallelujah. He's our Lord. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Worship him. Just worship him. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same sun, his name is worthy to be praised. Let everything that have breath praise his name. Hallelujah. Mighty good God, wonderful counselor, Prince of Peace, Emmanuel, God be with us. Bridge over troubled water, way out of no way. Mother and the Father, I tell you, Jesus.
Better than me. Somebody, he's worthy. Come on, somebody, he's worthy. Come on, somebody, he's worthy. Why is he worthy? Because he's been good to you. He's been good to you. Go find three people and tell them he's been good.
Yeah, I got you. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Sweeter than a honeycomb. Yes, he is. He's sweet, I know. Yes, he is. My Jesus. Oh, 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 yeah. My God is good. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I know the seniors can agree. Can I get at least five seniors to agree? He's been good. Great is the name of the Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures to all generations. Psalm 139. That's all right, give him some praise. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, our God is worthy. Worthy to be praised. Psalm 139, verse number 14. Let us pray. Gracious Master and Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. There's none like you from everlasting to everlasting. You are God. We thank you for you, for who you are, and we thank you for the things that you have done. We trust that this day you get the glory out of our gathering. It's the same old place, God, the same old prayer. Please preside over the preaching with precision, with passion, and with power. Help us by the aid of the Holy Spirit to be lucid in our language, exceptional exegesis, wise in our words, true to the text, salient in the sermon. While these, your people, are just as receptive as they will be responsive to your word. Holy Spirit, this is your time to have your way. Think with my mind and speak with my mouth. You are the real preacher. Continue to convince, convict, and convert into the conformity of Christ. We thank you for what you have done, but we're trusting you for what you're going to do. It's in the matchless name of Jesus that we pray. Amen and amen. There you have it, Psalm 139, verse number 14. Therein it says, according to the English Standard Version, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. And just for a little while, I'm going to put a tag on this text. It's a wonderful life. By now, the networks have aired at least twice, to my recollection, one of my favorite holiday motion pictures, starring James Stewart, Donna Reed, and directed by Frank Capra, called It's a Wonderful Life. It tells the story of a man who's made great sacrifices so that others could have a better quality of life. But when life happens to him, he becomes discouraged and thinks of ending it all until he is reminded of the imprint that he has left in the lives of others by showing him what his life would have been like had he not been there. There are many spiritual nuances that occur throughout the movie, particularly at the beginning and at the end. In the beginning, we hear the angels conversing about him. When the angels ask an interesting question, it blows my mind every time I hear it. He said, "What is he, sick?" The lead angel says, "No, worse." And some of us think sick is bad enough. But he said, "No, worse. He's discouraged." Amen, somebody. Because discouragement can be worse sometimes than sickness. And so they dispatch, you know, the character Clarence. And they bring Clarence up to speed on George's life since he was a child, and he goes down to save him from committing suicide and to show him what life for others would have been if he had not been around. And after he realizes how important and integral he was, one of the other things that's remarkable to me, he starts praying on the side of the bridge. And as he prays, he calls out, and he calls out to the angel's name, which was Clarence in the movie. He keeps on calling Clarence, "Clarence, I want to live again. Help me, Clarence." But nothing happens until he says, "Please, God." Then the snow starts to fall, and then things go back to the way they were. And we know that the community had rallied around to bring him support and to show him love, to help him out of his troubles, in a way of expressing their gratitude to the things that he had done for them. All of us have our George Bailey moments at times, and we become discouraged because of the hand that life has dealt us. And it's sometimes difficult for us to play that hand with any expedience at all. But we must remember, my brothers and sisters, that each life has value. And the value is not realized by keeping it to yourself. It is really shown in what we give away. Some people think their value is better seen through their selfish behavior, but value is better seen through generosity and the giving of oneself and realizing who you are, knowing that you are blessed of God. And because we are blessed of God, we are to be blessings. Not just this time of year, but throughout each and every year that God gives us in the land of the dying while on our way to the land of the living. This number of psalm is unique. It has a companion, Psalm number 147. They are called omni psalms because if you read them carefully, you will discover that they highlight the omnipotence, the omniscience, and the omnipresence of God. Here throughout six stanzas within this particular psalm, David talks about in his meditations the power, the knowledge and wisdom and the presence of God. He asked God first and foremost to examine him thoroughly in order that he might affirm his innocence. The psalm, my brothers and sisters, is a prophetic message that is significantly different from the others because it helps us to see God the way he wants us to see him. And it helps us to see ourselves the way God wants us to see ourselves. He begins in verses 1 through 6 talking about the omniscience of the Lord. He says, "O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down, when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all of my ways. And even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it." His first meditation is on God's knowledge, that every aspect of his life was searched out and controlled by what the Lord knew about him and everything else. And when David asked God to search him, my brothers and sisters, he can do so in bold fashion because that Hebrew word for search here between verses 1 through 6 really means to look for something good. Now, oftentimes, my brothers and sisters, the badness about ourselves is easy to see. Amen, somebody. And it takes some time for us to see the good things about some of the people that are in our lives. And David knew he wasn't perfect. David knew he made mistakes. He knew he had made some bad choices. And so he asked God to search me, God. Because if you look, you'll see some good in me. Talk back with me. Because everybody can't ask God something like that because we think we got it all together. We think we don't say the wrong things. We think we don't do the wrong things. We have a high opinion of ourselves. But if others would really tell the story, talk back with me, it'd be a different story altogether than the one that you came up with. And so David is saying, you know all about me. You understand me because you made me. You know when I get up. You know when I sit down. You know the secret thoughts and imaginations that cross my mind. Yes, you are acquainted with all of my ways. Your best friend, your closest loved one, they know some of your ways. But the Lord knows all of our ways. Before we can utter a phrase, form a sentence, or speak one word, God already knows what you're going to say. And he knows it all together. God has us all boxed in. Amen, somebody. He contains us and he compartmentalizes us. He's in front of us. He's behind us. He's above us. He's beneath us. He's beside us all at the same time. And thankfully, he lays his hands on us in spite of ourselves. And David says, such knowledge is too wonderful for me because he understands that nobody knows us like the Lord knows us. And then he talks about God's omnipresence in verses 7 through 12, where it says, where shall I go from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not too dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. David says God is everywhere. And you can't hide from God. You can't get away from God's presence. Jonah assumed that he could. And when God had told him to go to Nineveh and preach revival, and I'm going to guarantee you that the whole city is going to come as candidates for baptism. Jonah said, no, not those who are the oppressors of my forefathers. No, I'm not going to preach to them because I know if I preach to them like you say, they're going to get saved. Jonah wanted them to be condemned. He wanted them to be consumed. And he said, I know what I'll do. I'll get away from God's presence. He left Jerusalem. He left Judah. He left the Holy Land thinking that he could get away from God. But God is right where you are. You can't even hide from yourself. How do you think you can hide from God? said, if I go to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in hell, you're there. He says, even in the darkness, it is as of light to you. If I could just mount up on wings and go to the uttermost parts of the sea, you're there. Your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall be upon me. He realized that it was impossible to escape from such omnipotent and omniscient control of God, no matter how far or fast he might go. God is everywhere. Not was everywhere. He is everywhere at the same time. And then he talks about the omnipotence of the Lord in verses 13 through 18. He says, for you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, that the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. How precious are your thoughts. How vast is the sum of them. If I would count them, they are more than the sand. I awake and I am still with you. David acknowledges the fact that God made us. He knows every cell, every molecule, things that are invisible to the natural eye. He knows how we are knitted together, even though our fingerprints are all different. We have different skin texture and complexion and hair and eyes and heights and widths and all these different things about us. God uniquely created each and every one of us. He made us and then he broke the mold. There has never been a you, and will never be another you after we're gone. And God is responsible for that. He says, I bless you, I praise you, because I understand this in the very depths of my soul. David then stated that God had such control over him because in his power he created him secretly and planned his life with great care. You need to believe that. Your life is planned by God with great care. That's what Jeremiah talks about in chapter 29, verse 11. Know the plans that I have for you. Plans not to harm you, but plans to help you, plans to keep you, plans to build you up, and plans to give you a great future. But brothers and sisters, a lot of people get those ideas jaded. Life gets difficult. Life gets challenging. Life gets hard. But your times are in the hand of God. He that keeps Israel never slumbers or sleep. And so if he that keeps Israel never slumbered or sleep, we're not Israel, we're the church. He that keeps Israel, or he that can keep the church, the believers, the postmodern body of Christ, because of his omnipotence, God has the power. And then David talks about his loyalty to God. When others would turn their backs on God, when others would slander or sneer at God, David says in verses 19 through 24, oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. O men of blood, depart from me. They speak against you with malicious intent. Your enemies take your name in vain. He says, do I not hate those that hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with complete hatred. I count them my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me to the way everlasting. David makes strong statements in these verses. He has what scholars call righteous indignation. Righteous indignation is when you have a displeasure for those who vaunt themselves against God and the things of God. In Scripture, the way it is written, it is one of those $5 word with nickel meaning, but I've said it before, hyperbolic statements. I mean, it's a strong statement. It's an exaggerated statement. Not really meaning that David has hatred to anyone, but he's basically saying, if you got a problem with God, then you got a problem with me. Because I'm a child of God, because I belong to God. David wants all to come into faith. David wanted all to put their trust in God, or else it would not have been said, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who trusts in him. But he knew that there were nations, there were kings, there were people who would talk down on God and talk down on God's people. And so he says, I hate them with complete hatred, and I count them as enemies, because any enemy of God is an enemy of mine. But he asks God again at the end, the same thing that he does at the beginning. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Look for something good. I know I messed up, but if you look at my heart, you'll see some good things. If you try me, you'll see that I have some good and noble thoughts. And he says, if you see anything grievous in me, anything that needs correcting, anything that needs to be removed, remove it. I resign my will. I submit my will to you, because all I want you to do is lead me into the way everlasting. And sometimes to get into the way everlasting, we have to get out of our own way. David says, I'm getting out the way, and I need you to examine me, and I don't want anything to block me, including myself, from everything that you have for me. And so there are timeless truths that are trapped within the treasury of this text that are tailored to teach us just how wonderful our life really is. Verse 14 says, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. We are a wonderful creation. We are a wonderful creation. He says, I would praise you. That word praise out of original language really means to throw or to cast. It is as if David is saying, let me throw this in. And every now and then you need to throw some praise in a situation. Every now and then you need to throw some praise in the workplace. Students, you need to throw some praise in at school. You need to throw some praise in your household. In life's difficult moments, you need to throw some praise in those times, because God is still good. He says, I praise you because I know who I am. And I know that it's not because of me that I'm here. My existence really had nothing to do with mom and dad. It was because you made me fearfully and wonderfully. Fearfully really just means to be respected or to be in awe of. And we are all fearfully and wonderfully made. But the problem is with a whole lot of people is that some people think they're more fearfully and wonderfully made than another person. But this verse right here puts us all pretty much on the same level. Believers who read the Bible in faith, we are all fearfully and wonderfully made. That word wonderful means not to be surpassed. We are God's crowning achievement as far as creation is concerned. Because God ever so casually created everything else. The universe, the worlds, the planets, the stars, the galaxy, the sun, the moon, the mountains, the rivers, the valley. He pretty much created everything by a spoken word. That was casual for God. But when he made man, it was intimate. Now, there's a big difference then from something casual and something that is intimate. He said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. And then God organized dust. And when he organized dust, he made man. And who else do you know made anything out of dust? Hallelujah, somebody. You can't even grab dust. All you can do is move it out your way. But God organized dust, made man, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the scriptures say that he became a living soul. Hallelujah, somebody. That transcends us above every other living and breathing creature. That we have an identity with God. Idolaters made images out of what they believe God to be. Animals, birds, fish, lions, bears, tigers, they would make animals. And sometimes they would make a part animal and part man. Erect a statue, a carving, and worship that they had made. Essentially using what God had created to worship instead of worshiping God. We are his crowning achievement. We are intrinsically connected to God, whether we believe it or not, or whether we accept it or not. Because you do know there are some people who reject not only salvation, but they reject the Creator, which is God. They believe in the theories that are put out by philosophers and scientists, the Big Bang Theory, Darwinism, and other such notions for the existence of the material universe and man. But David here acknowledges the fact that, no, I'm not an ancestor of an ape. I'm not a relative of an ape as an ancestor. He said, I was created in the image and likeness of God. I am wonderfully made. We're wonderfully made, but also, my brothers and sisters, we have a wonderful collection. In that same verse, he says, wonderful are your works. I think that's what the choir was trying to sing in two distinct songs just a while ago. His works are wonderful. Same meaning as it did when we are wonderfully made. His works cannot be surpassed. They cannot be equal. They cannot be matched. The things that God has done for you, nobody can touch it. And nobody can top it. Amen, somebody. His works are wonderful. When he healed you, it was wonderful. It astounded your physician. It was so wonderful. When he got you out of trouble, it was wonderful. Oh, you had just given up on the whole situation. Yeah, I'm going to have to pay the money or I'm going to have to do the time. But his deliverance was wonderful. Hallelujah, somebody. The ways and the means that he used in order for you to live the quality of life that you live right now, it's not because you deserve it so much. It's not because you're so educated. It's not because you're from the right family. You have the right heredity. It is because of the wonderful works of God. Everything that he has done for us is wonderful. I wish I had a few people here that could just take a moment to inventory the collection of great works that God has performed in our lives. Wonderful creation, and we have wonderful collection, but then David has wonderful clarification. He says, I'm not going to even attempt to take the credit for it. He says, I'm fearfully, wonderfully made. You have wonderful works. He says, I know this very well. But it's not just a matter of knowing for David. David took what he knew on the inside and was always willing to express it on the outside. He didn't need a pep rally. He didn't need a cheerleader. He didn't need a drum major to get him going. David blessed God just because. That's why he could say, I will bless the Lord at all times. And his praises are continually in my mouth. My soul makes her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be made glad. And then he said, because I'm praising him, I want everybody to praise him. He says, oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. He says, I know this full well. Because David took the time to think, to reflect, and to take retrospective looks into his life. From where he had come from to where he is right now. And I recommend everybody do that every now and then. Think about where you come from to where you are right now. That you ought to go through that for your entire lifespan. You think about where you come from to where you are right now. And you will conclude that if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, I'd hate to think about where I would be. I'd hate to think about how the story would have ended if the Lord wasn't on my side. I hate to think about the outcome if the Lord wasn't on my side. If the Lord wasn't on your side, it's doubtful that you'd be sitting here today. Hallelujah, somebody. He was on your side. Raise your hand if you had surgery. That's a lot of y'all. A lot of people had surgery and they died on the table for the same thing that you have. Hallelujah, somebody. That same thing you have. Some of them had the same doctor you had. But the Lord was on your side. Retirees, where are you? They hired a lot of people the day they hired you. And you seen some of them getting marched out the door. Wherever so-and-so, oh, they got fired. They got laid off. God let you work 25, 35, 40 years. You ain't show up on time every day. You didn't stay off your manager, your supervisor's nerves. You weren't the ideal coworker or employee at all times. The Lord was on your side. Hallelujah, somebody. There are people here today because God was on your side. We like to pout about what happened. Yeah, something happened. Yeah, you made a mistake. Yeah, you had an accident. You on pout. Yeah, you lost something. Yeah, you messed up a relationship. But the Lord is still on your side. And the outcome of those things that would normally occur are not as bad as it could have been because of God's grace and because of his mercy. And David could acknowledge those things, and during this season and any season, we ought to be able to acknowledge God with wonderful clarification. You may not be able to afford what you want to do for the holidays. But that doesn't mean God ain't good. And some people are disenfranchised by something that they want. God makes sure you have everything that you need. That's what's most important. Because God knows sometimes what we want may not be ideal for us. But what we need is his grace. You know what happened to Paul, don't you? When he was praying again in the spirit, he said, I was deep. I was in my shando. He said, I prayed this prayer three times to God. I asked him to remove my thorn. And while I was in my shando, Paul says, I heard stuff I wasn't supposed to hear, saw stuff I wasn't supposed to see. He was way in his shando. Talk back with me. And he said, I asked God, because since you let me see all this stuff, since you let me hear all this stuff, this is a good time to ask you about that thorn. I'm bringing it up again. And he said, you know what God told me? He said, my grace is sufficient for you. Because grace does not always satisfy our wants, but it does always satisfy our needs. And we've got to know this very well, that we have everything that we need in God. So despite what people may think of you, how they may feel toward you, you are a wonderful creation. And despite how differently God may be blessing somebody else, because we always asking God to do for us what he's doing for somebody else, you need to know what the choir sang back in the 90s. It said, what God has for me, it is for me. You have to personalize that. What God has for you may not be for me. And what God has for me may not be for you. But be content in knowing what God has for me is for me. All of us in here have got some wonderful collections. If we could just but acknowledge and appreciate it. And then we've got wonderful clarification. The fact that we know that God is good. He's so good that as we celebrate this time of year, he sent his son, Jesus, on a 9-month train through 42 generations, some suggest 72 burning worlds, and he dropped anchor for him down in Bethlehem of Judea. It wasn't the one of the best places in the world to be born, but Jesus was born there. And like I told you last week, don't get wrapped up in the baby that was born, because that's only as far as some people can take it in their so-called intimate relationship with God. But we've got to thank him at all times for the man that died, because that was the real gift. They didn't understand the gift when he came. They didn't understand the gift upon arrival. And even when he began his ministry, it became apparent to him and those closest around him that he came into his own, but his own received him not. But I'm grateful, because the rest of that verse in John 1:14 says, but as many as received him, that's you and me, to them he gave power, even to be power to be the sons and daughters of God. So as he came and we have accepted him, we have realized him to be our most treasured possession, the greatest gift that has ever been given, the gift that keeps on giving, that never becomes outdated or obsolete, that is always available, never becomes inoperable. The gift that lasts not only in this lifetime, but gives us the full assurance that we will be a part of eternity in the next lifetime. It is enraptured of that Pentecostal litany that I like to use just about every week, that says, living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. But rising, he justified freely and forever. And one day, he's coming back. Oh, what a glorious day. So it doesn't matter what's happening in your life right now, it's still a wonderful life. Don't give up on God. David discovered that God, if you don't give up on God, God won't give up on you. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the other things will be added unto you. So it's a wonderful life, this life that we lead with God. And as I get ready to go to my seat, be not dismayed. Stop complaining. Stop being mean and low down. Get over yourself, because God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love, that's where you abide. God will take care of you through every day and all the way. He will take care of you. Let me see the hands of those who are saved and know that you're saved. Is there somebody here today couldn't raise your hand just then. We want you to be able to raise your hand the next time you hear the question posed to you. Salvation is God's greatest gift. It didn't come cheap. God gave his best in Jesus. Jesus gave it all that he had in order to purchase our redemption. And when he died, one of the things he said was, "It is finished." Everything necessary to reconcile man back to God, he fulfilled it on the cross. Then on the third day morning, he rose from the grave as the first fruits unto the resurrection. What that means is because Jesus got up. Don't know when, don't know where. But the song says, some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away. I'm going to be raptured to be with the Lord when he comes. And if you want that, we extend to you this invitation. But it's a matter of faith. Not faith that someone else has, because faith doesn't work by proxy. You got to have faith yourself and trust God. For the just shall live by their faith. And there's one here today who want to acknowledge the faith that they have in God by confessing with your mouth, believing in your heart the Lord Jesus, that God raised him from the dead. The scriptures promise you shall be saved. Almost in an instant, the seniors say it like this, quicker than right now and sooner than after a while. Yes, you too can be saved, like the hands that you saw elevated a while ago. Everybody gets saved the same way, by praying that prayer, asking God for it, and believing in God that we have it, and trusting God to sanctify us and to develop us as we go through life's journey. And you can have that promise if you're here today, or if you're viewing this on YouTube or on the telecast. You can have it right here and right now by praying to God and saying, Lord, forgive me of my sins. Lord, come into my heart. Lord, save my soul. I believe that Jesus paid it all. God will save you. And then he wants us to become a part of a local assembly of believers, whereby we could faithfully grow in God's grace. That's God's goal for you. And I want to challenge you to get in step with God's goal for your life. Let us pray. God, be thanked and be praised for who you are, the things that you have done. We thank you. And we praise you for the favor, the forgiveness, the faithfulness, the fruitfulness, and the future that we have in Christ Jesus. Save a sinner, Lord. Reclaim a backslider. Let your house be a priority for them. Let them acknowledge your presence, your wisdom, your power in their lives. Let them experience, Lord God, your favor and your mercy each and every day of their lives. Plant them in a Bible-loving, Bible-learning, Bible-living church where they will be laborers, a laborer who will be resourceful, a laborer who will be reliable, a laborer who will be responsible for your causes, that you might help them to work out their soul salvation with fear and trembling. Do it for your glory, oh God. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. If there are none present among us, to respond to the invitation on your way to your seat, give God some praise, thanking Him for your wonderful life.